Hi everyone, my name is Meetup. So I am actually working as a technology software engineer. So today I am presenting on mentoring courses. So let's start with the agenda for today. So first of all, we will do is demo application. That is a Go application, not mentoring. Try to find the root cause of an issue. And then what we will do is we get an introduction about mentoring and why is it important. And then we will also get an introduction to what software engineering and syscalls. And the next thing we will try to do is that basically, we'll develop the application again with the help of monitoring and observability tools. And then finally, we'll add our vision analysis. So let's start directly by jumping into the code and then let's see how we can like basically debug an application where there is no monitoring that is present in the application. Cool. So here basically I have a kind of sample application. So it's a so basically here I have a books application. So it's a simple criteria with some graph and bonds. So
is it better now?
Yeah. So this is a simple books CRUD application. So here I have the endpoints for creating, updating, and listing books. So this is a simple one. And then let's see what the find books. So here it is. You can see what it does is it basically queries the database and then it runs all the loops. And let's try to run this application and check out this endpoint. Great, so application has started. Let's try to hit the get books endpoint. So you can see with this get book endpoint over here. Yeah, we can get the list of books. So this is a pretty straightforward one. Now let's say we wanted to introduce a feature where basically we want to reduce the time of the basically the get endpoint. And let's say we want to introduce caching. So what I will do is let's say for our business we decided to let's introduce caching for our endpoint. So let's do that. So I have already put the code, I'm just uncommenting. So what I will do is I'll first comment out the code which is directly written from the database. So what it does is basically it stores a variable in memory and then returns if it's already present. So I will uncomment this function. So I now start my application and then I will get it. So everything seems to be fine and we'll also we found out that basically our latency has reduced. Now let's say we deploy this to production. And let's say after some days, some users report that basically your endpoint, the API is working fine, but at point of time since latency is way higher than expected. Now what will you do? So basically, since you don't have any monitoring or tools in place, what you'll do is we'll try to check logs if you can find anything. So the first thing that we'll do is you can check the logs. So if there is anything, so let's say what I will do is I will run a bash script which will. So I will run a bash script which will hit the endpoint number of times. So let's do that. So this script is basically hitting the endpoint number of times. So let's say this is a production application where users are using it. So what I will do is I will monitor the logs. So here you can see. For the most amount of time, the response time is 50 milliseconds. But you can see certain times it's around 400 milliseconds. Again, here is one which is 400 milliseconds. But it's hitting the same endpoint. Now, in this case, what will you do? So, the next thing that will do that you will most probably do is get the endpoint that the user is trying to use and send the same payload. But in this case, this is the get endpoint, and even if you try to replicate it, you won't be able to replicate it properly. So, the next thing that you will do is So the next thing you will do is you can, since this is a monolithic application and this is a you have the idea about the code base. What you do is you most probably at the time of different functions check which functions that might be taking more time. So let's say this is the function that I've written, right? So what I'll do is I will start a timer and then end a timer. So what I'm doing here is basically starting the timer at the starting of the. So I'm starting the timer at the start of the function. And then I'm writing a input function which will bring the duration of this function. So now let's run
this application.
Hello. So let's run this application. Now again, I will run the script which is killing in time, multiple number of times. And then here also we can
check the different. I think it's getting disconnected.
So basically, you can see the duration of the input function. So for like this, you can basically add for multiple number of functions and then check the response time. So basically, here we want to know basically some of these requests, the function is taking around 1.6 microseconds, and then for some of the requests, it is taking around 4 milliseconds. So from this, we got to know about the idea. Then basically this is the function where the instrument is. Now the next thing is basically, since this is the application that we have control of, we are able to debug it locally. Now let's say you are in a, like basically you are in a microservices environment where your request goes through a lot of services. Now in that case, what will you do? If you don't have a monitoring system in place, you will have to set up all the microservices in your system and then raise the request from one point to another locally. And it will be very difficult. Like if you're trying with like 5-6 microservices, because they will have a lot of dependencies, they would have need a lot of databases and stuff, and like it will be pretty difficult for you to like debug the application. And also a pointer application. Because here what happened is basically you had no idea that your API had an issue. It was a customer that reported that basically sometimes this happens that your response time is quite high, while the other times it's not. So let's get an introduction to monitoring now. So what is monitoring? So it's basically the process of collecting data so that you can analyze it and get the status of your application, like how it's performing, where is the issue, where might be the issue. So that is like monitoring. And then why is monitoring important? So here you can see two images. One is the monolithic and the one is the microservices. So in one, right? So we have a like basically a single example, right? That basically if we have one single backend, it's pretty easy to like find out the issue where you can basically run a local setup, set up debug points and then get the issue where the issue might be going and then you can debug it. But let's say your microservices where your request is going to like tens and hundreds of services, you have no idea like where might be the issue, because like you might not be the owner of the service. So let's say you are owner of only one service. You have the idea about the code base, but other services might be written in some other languages, or you might be using some other APIs like external APIs, and you don't have idea about it. So in that case, how will you debug? So that's where monitoring comes into place, so that you can monitor your applications and debug them pretty efficiently. And next comes, what are the things that you should monitor in your application? So first thing is the application metrics, like what is the response time of your application, how it is performing, and then traces. By traces I mean, let's say there is a transaction or a request that is coming, how it is flowing through your entire application, like how it is flowing through different number of services. You should know like what is the flow of it. And then the node level metrics, so if it's a physical or a virtual machine, so let's say how much CPU is used, how much memory is used, and stuff. And the same thing for containers. So let's say you have a computer running, you want to know like how much space of computer for containers, how much memory, RAM, those things. And the same goes for Kubernetes pods if you're using Kubernetes to deploy applications. So we got an idea about OpenMonitoring. So let's get an introduction to OpenMonitoring. So basically we got the idea of monitoring, it will help us monitor applications, get the state of it. Now let's get an introduction to OpenMonitoring. So what OpenMonitoring is basically it's a set of APIs and SDK which will allow you to instrument your application. Now, this is a vendor-agnostic one. So once you instrument your application, let's say your core application or your kind of application, once you instrument them with open telemetry, you will be able to export it into any backend. So whether it's being like private one or an open source one, like something like Meetup, like it's a private one, but when you relate those kind of things. And then Classic also has an NPM. So you'll be able to export those data into the and then resolve it. And open telemetry actually was one by job combining two projects. One is the open census and the open list. So open census is basically the APIs that generated that we will use for instrumenting our applications. And then open tracing was basically set up APIs and SDK that like basically Google set so that you can instrument different applications, Go, Java, and other languages. And one important thing that open telemetry provides is basically once you collect the data, you can export into multiple packets. So let's say you want to export into data log, you want to export into view really, you can also export into like other databases like 3000 and stuff. And the last thing about the open telemetry is basically it is just the APIs and SDKs. It's not a backend for storing your telemetry data. So open telemetry will just take care of how to instrument your application and get the data and process it. It won't store your data. So that is what open telemetry is. Now let's look at what SIGMOS is. So basically SIGMOS is a full stack open like monitoring and observability platform where you can visualize your monitoring data. So all the data that you collect from open telemetry, you can do powerful aggregation on top of it and visualize all the data that you collect. Now the next thing we will do is basically, we have seen the example where we debug our application without monitoring. Now let's do the same with monitoring. So what I will do is I will make some changes into our code so that we collect some instrumentation data and then find out where the issue is without going into the code and write it on the production. So what I will do is, I will change the branch. Yeah, so a couple of things that I did here. So first thing that I did here was basically to initialize that user. What is basically means it means that we run open telemetry API in the background to collect the data and send it to open telemetry. And the next thing I did is basically since we are using Gene for creating our REST APIs, so I have used the open telemetry Gene middleware to instrument the Gene APIs request. And then I'll also add the plugin for Golang. So basically I'm using the Golang with a library for using my database. So I use the hotel board plugin to instrument the data response. And since we have automated instrumentation for request and the database calls, I will also add a span to my get cache. So basically since what a span is basically, span is the like operation you can say. So we have traces and traces the collection of operation. So here get cache is an operation and then we can create a span here. Now this span will add the entire duration and more metadata into this function to the get. So this is the thing that I need. So I add a span and then add the span here. So it will end once the function is completed. So now let's run this application. For running this application, I'll add some environment variables so that data is sent to open telemetry collector. So here what I've done is I've added the name of my service, that is Go service, and I've added the authentic endpoint where basically all my metrics data are inside. And I will run the application. Okay. And then I will simply the same thing by running my batch, which will basically send the So let's say this is deployed for production and then our monitoring data is also getting done. And let's let it run for checking so that good amount of data is collected and we can see, visualize the stuff. So until then, like, let's say I did this stuff, right? So basically I added a few lines of code to instrument my application. Now once you do that, you are basically, you don't need to change anything. So let's say you are using some vendor specific APIs, right? Let's say then you decide to move to something else. Then what you have to do is you have to like change your entire code base across microservices to basically instrument your image. With open element, you do it once, and then let's say you want to change your vendor, like user error or something, then in that you stop your vendor. So that's the follow up open element, and like it's the standard that is getting added to the distributed systems. Okay, let's wait a few moments so that good amount of data is in. So here I have open CMOS, which is the like user agent platform for open delivery. So I will go to, so since my service name of the since my service name was book service, I'll go to book service. Okay, let's wait for a few moments. Sorry, I'll go to one of the next right. So right now it only has been done. So okay. So from this we can see we have the PPT latency, P95 latency, and the P99. So by PPT latency it means that 50% of my request is less than 50 milliseconds, while 95% of my request is less than, like, serving less than 457 milliseconds. So we got some idea that basically 50% is less than 58, but for some of the other requests are basically less than 457, which is not acceptable for us. So what we'll do is we'll try to recover the issue from this console only. So what I'll do here is I will click on view traces. So here I have all the traces for checkpoint in time. So here I can see that my catbook endpoint is taking 455 milliseconds, while it's taking 54 milliseconds for some ranges. So the next thing I will do is I will check where this catbook function is basically taking more time. So from this we can directly see that our catbook is basically the culprit here. So it's taking 400 milliseconds. Now we directly got to know from the UI itself where to find the data. So I can directly now go to my code base. Let's say this is a distributed system with a lot of microservices. You can directly find out which microservice, which function has the issue, and directly go there and debug it. So this will save you a lot of time, and you can basically debug your applications on the fly. And the next thing like you can do once you instrument your application is like do a lot of stuff. So let's say I want to check the maximum duration that is taken by request, which is HTTP code 200. So I can also say jump it. So what I request that is HTTP code 200. I can see it. So syscalls provides a powerful UI to basically aggregate all your data and then gain insights so that you can debug your applications faster to open them with your data. So this is the architecture of syscalls. So basically we have the applications which are generating the metrics data. So this can be any kind of application, like thickness, it doesn't need to be code, but it can be any kind of application which is generating metrics data. And then you have the auto connector, which will collect all your metrics and telemetry data. And then we store it to Quirks, which is a powerful OLAP database, so that you can do powerful aggregations. And then we have our query service. So we have written a query service such that you can do powerful aggregations on top of Quirks, so that you can gain great good insights about your application. And then we have the content, which is written in here, so people as a data. So it's an open source project, you can check it out on github.com/syscalls. Yeah, that's it from Grace Log. Thank you. If you have any questions, go to the second slide.
Sorry, second slide.
Do you want the mic?
No, go to the next one. More telegram, the plugins installed is in Keen and more telegram.
Yes.
These are the custom or open telemetry devices.
Yeah, so that is maintained by the
company. It can,
that is maintained by the company.
Repeat the question.
Hotel gene is maintained by the open telemetry maintainers, and the working program is maintained by upgrades.
portal one is maintained by Apex right now. But everything is maintained by Apex.
But if any changes,
yes, you have to make it appear. Or you can maintain it yourself.
Yeah.
Oh, we have a question.
So you use data, you can visualize your tracing data, right? And you can put up an instrument. So previously what the AWS used to do is they provide your own APIs for instrument verification. What OpenTelemetry does is provides a common API, that is standard API for instrumental application. Now with that you can use Jaeger also. So once you instrument your application like OpenTelemetry, you can export the data to Jaeger as well as Prometheus. And let's say you have already instrumented your application with Prometheus and OpenTelemetry. In that case also, OpenTelemetry provides a way to basically convert your data from Jaeger or Prometheus to something that is OpenTelemetry compatible, and then also you can export it to something else.
This is for multi language platform.
Yes.
My question is more of the context parameter that we are passing. Assume that there is sufficiently large application where we have done so much more. So, in order to enable OpenTelemetry, we now need to pass the context parameter to the three function. So, don't you think that will be a tedious task? Because so far I don't have context parameter because I was not needing it for my business uses. It was rather required for to solve these two parameters. How do you suggest to have it? Because assuming a sufficient task code, pass modifying every single function can be quite tedious task. So do you have any just as like lambda functions where you rather like wrap this function inside a lambda and correct the metrics rather than modifying the signature of functions? So,
yeah, that was actually a nice question, but like if you don't have much idea about how you can wrap your function in lambda and whether you can arrange a memory with you. So I might not be able to answer that, but regarding the context, so basically right now what I can see is basically all the libraries or things that you can do, everybody is moving to context because it helps in a lot of ways, like you have to do request cancellation and other stuff. So basically context is something that everybody is moving to, and then OpenTelemetry or syscalls basically move into context. But yeah, since you have a lot of applications, like I don't have a solution, but yeah, eventually you have to move to context if you want to like instrument your application.
If you want to get span, you have to move to context.
Yeah. So
if you want to go to span, you have to move to context.
Yes.
Can I add to that?
Yeah.
Oh, so adding to that, there are no trade robots in Go. So you won't find something like that in Go. This is the only way, and it is tedious. But adding a context parameter to all your function calls, right? Since this is static language, you shouldn't find refactoring that too hard. Right? And context.
Yeah.
I mean, one thing that I feel is it is like if you are doing some releases for the parking system, this parameter makes, like, this parameter doesn't, is only purely used to do some non functional, which might confuse any interfaces that you have in a system because that, let's say a book interface which is supposed to actually look at certain books, and now to enable OpenTelemetry and sort of over-editing the items in context window, which might not make sense from a product point of view, like from a design point of view. So, I mean, in other languages, since we have thread context or MDC attached to it, it is possible to do it. Just exploring how to do this.
Yeah, sure. Then one final point is that as part of Google's guidelines for Go, right, context should be the first parameter for any function call you're doing. So we have already about.
Okay, and if we should want to discuss it, but we can also discuss it.
actually being in cluster and together. So yeah, so that's pretty much about me. And so I usually spend the next 15 minutes or so listening to me. In this case of abstraction, we sometimes forget what happens underneath any high language we're using. Not just Google, say, for a Python program or anything. We often forget that what happens underneath the program. So the objective of this talk is to make you realize that what happens underneath when you run a simple code program and not really talking any advanced stuff. And it should actually help you becoming capable and understand how you can debug your program, say if you are stuck with maybe a deadlock or something. And also if you're curious in general to know what happens inside. So coming to what are syscalls. So syscalls are basically an interface between your application and the kernel. So this is the man page of syscall. I don't know if it's visible to everyone, but it's the fundamental interface how your application will interact with the kernel. So so there are a couple of famous utilities through which you can see syscalls. So if you're on a Linux machine, you can use sbase. Sbase will so what you can do is add the path to your binary. It will follow all the syscalls which are happening underneath, and you will get to know what how your program actually interacts with the kernel. And similarly, since I'm on a Mac right now, I'm using vBrush. It also uses vBrush, which is a PSD port of sbase. So yeah, this is about the utility which you can use to understand the syscalls which are made by your program. So yeah, coming back to we drifted away to syscalls quite a bit. So coming back to Go, so this is a simple program. Yeah, this is a simple program. It just prints hello world. And what I did was, let's get to know where our program actually sits. So if this is visible to you, this is a program, and let's start from the bottom. This is the computer hardware. Then we have the kernel, and this is the syscall interface. And after that, we have the user space. So if you have a Go program, if you have a Python program, it usually runs in the user space. And this is where currently my Go program is. And the Go program uses the Go runtime to run itself, and it will talk about the Go scheduler in a bit. So just to give an understanding, the program sits somewhere on top of the syscall interface and uses the syscall interface to interact with the kernel. So let's try to trace the syscalls which happen when I run this program. So I combine the binary, and so that in that case it will be pthread underscore gate. But here you can see there are around 1, 2, 3, and again I think about here. So 4 threads are being created here by my simple error program. Also here is where the write happens. So you can see here a write call is made which actually outputs the program to the STDO. So this is the system call which is used to write to the STDO. And then we also have KQ here, which we'll talk about later. So this was just a simple hello world program. Why did we need more than one thread for just printing hello world? So the answer to this is, if you see these code snippets are from the Go runtime. So it's a very great code base. If you want to learn how the Go runtime works, you can definitely, you can just go into runtime/proc.go and you'll find this code base. This is definitely a must read for everyone who wants to understand how the Go runtime works. So here you can see, this is the main Go routine. So let's go back to our Go ones. So we have a main function here. So the main function itself is a goroutine, and that's why what our scheduler does is, and the goroutine does is, first of all, it starts a new thread to run the system monitor. So the goroutine needs a system monitor to understand what's happening underneath. And since the main goroutine is blocked by the goroutine, the go scheduler spawns a new thread so that it can execute other operations. And similarly, the other threads are needed for running the garbage collector, the timing for timing program. So one thing you might be thinking about, the famous Go max procs variable. So that's why I have quoted the Go runtime here. If you see Go max constructs, it actually limits the number of operating system threads that can execute user-level code code segments. So it actually doesn't limit the number of threads which are blocked on syscalls. It will just block the user-level code code. So if you're thinking that I said Gopan's process for 2 and my program will only spawn 2 threads, that's totally incorrect. It depends on a number of things, but Gopan's process control the number of threads. I just added some print statements here to understand what's happening. So I'm running an MP machine with 8 logical cores, so that's why you see here number of logical CPUs are 8. Number of OS threads are 5 and the number of board is 0.1. This is actually misleading. It actually responds more than one board read. But by the time we reach the print statement, the other board reads might have expired. So, since this was a lot about how threads are interacting and how Go routines are working, I thought let's just touch on the Go scheduler. So, the Go scheduler has three important components, which are P, M, and G. P stands for processor, like logical processor. So, if you have eight cores, you might have 8 processors running. M is a worker thread, like OS thread, and G is a Go routine. And also the scheduler has LRQ and GRQ. LRQ is the local RAM queue. So each processor can have its own RAM queue. And for Go routines, like the whole Go routine will also have a global RAM queue. So all the Go routines which have not been executed will reside in the Go RAM queue. I'll talk about this LRQ and GRQ again. But to sum it up, the Go scheduler's job is to distribute ready to run Go routines over worker threads. So, say there are 5 threads, my Go scheduler will make sure that the Go routines which are ready to run should be distributed over the work threads. So, in scheduling, generally there are 2 paradigms, work stealing and work sharing. So, work stealing is basically if I have 2 processors and one of the processors is underutilized, it will try to steal some work from the other processor. And work sharing is that attempts to migrate if it's overloaded. So yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, your work stealing and work sharing. So let's take a look at how the Go scheduler works here. This is the runtime code which I was mentioning. It's actually a must read. So if you see the comments in the Go runtime code itself, they say very simply in plain English, one round of scheduler finds the runnable Go routine and executes it. It never returns. So here is the implementation of the scheduler, how it works. So we have 2 processors here. These M are their worker threads. And these are the loading queue. As I told you earlier, each processor will have its own loading queue. And then we have that loading queue, which is loaded to the Go routine. And now we can see the stealing in action. So what we do here is that I have a processor P1, I have a processor P2, but the P2 was the thread about P2 is done executing itself. So it's actually underutilized right now, and the loading queue of P1 still has a lot of jobs to do. So the P2 here, since it can't find work, it steals some Go routines from P1. So the loading queue of P1 will be empty and it will be transferred to the P2. So, and the function which does this in the Go runtime is called run queue steal. It's again the Go runtime, and it will steal half of the elements from the local runtime queue of the other processor. It doesn't necessarily need to be P2 because you might have more than one processor. And it will transfer this the Go routine from the other processor to the underutilized processor. So yeah, this is actually the work stealing. So now if you realize that the Go scheduler uses work stealing. So it's stealing the Go routines from if the processor is underutilized. But does this really happen? I mean, how can we see this in action? So Go actually ships with a very nice utility called Go Debugger, which will let you know how you can trace on every the government tech is doing. So I actually did that on my program, and this is the output of Go debug. So if you see, I had specified here that I want the trace of my output, and if you can, for the sake of simplicity, I have specified Goldman's procs as 2. So the specific Goldman's procs 2 here is limiting the number of processors, not threads. So if you see, I mentioned Goldman's procs as 2, and in the output, you see, I have only 2 logical processors, P0 and P1. So this is how actually the scripter is working. So I have a full stack trace, I can show that to you as well. So yeah, that's how you can use code and try to understand what's happening inside the scheduler. So now here you can see we have 2 processors, P0, P1. We have status is equal to 1, which means both processors are working right now. And coming to the threads, we have 5 threads, M1, M0, okay, I think, yeah, 5 threads, M0 to M4. And also you can see we have a run queue for each processor. Just a second. Here. Run queue size is equal to 0. Here. So you can actually watch the scaling in action also. What you can do is that you can, in the, like for example, right now I'm giving the trace for every 2 milliseconds. So you can run the trace for every 2 milliseconds. And what you can notice is that in one of the queues, it might be empty and the other 2 might be full. And in the next interval, you will see that the run queue of the empty run queue might get filled and the other one might get half. So this actually happens. I'll go to the actual stack trace and show you. And apart from that, you can see how many idle processors we have, how many threads we have. So spinning threads is also a concept, but not covering this spinning threads in this talk. And then we have all our board names running here, which are denoted by G and the number of board names. So yeah, this is how you can use board name to understand how the scheduler actually works in action. So coming to how the future of syscalls looks like, so you might have understood it looks bright. Let's understand what happens right now. So all Unix, IO, syscalls are right now synchronous and blocking. Synchronous, it means that atomically only one syscall operation will happen one time. But to us, it's not like, I mean, as an application developer, to us, it might feel asynchronous thanks to select and KQ. So select and KQ, these two utilities make the whole process asynchronous behind the scenes. So let's understand what happens right now. So this is a traditional operation for every program. I'll explain this to you. So this is my program, and it made a system call to read something to KQ. So KQ is that asynchronous syscall scheduling queue, and my syscall was transferred to the corner, and then I wait for the corner to respond. So it waits for the corner to respond, and as soon as the corner responds, the control again transfers back to the program. So mind you, the program was in sleep till the corner returned back. And once the corner returns back the action, and then the program takes the action. So here you can see my interactions with the corner are 2. First of all, I transfer a syscall, and then I get data that okay, I can take an action, and then I again call the kernel to take the actual action which I want to do. But let's see how we can improve this. So there has been a recent development in the Linux kernel, and in 2019 in the Linux main kernel, the IO doing subsystem was released. So this actually solves for inherently synchronous Linux IO. So I'll talk about IO equipment and see how it solves the working. So again, we're back to the same diagram, but if you notice here, what happens is that I again submit my read request with the action to IOUring, and IOUring again transfers the control to kernel. Right now my program is in sleep. But what happens here now is the kernel, as soon as it notifies IOUring that arguing itself makes the call to the kernel, informing the kernel that this action should be taken. And then kernel transfers the result back directly to the program. So let's compare both of the diagrams, what was happening before and now. So here if you see, previously the program had to transfer the action what needs to be done to the kernel, and then the result would have been given by the kernel to the program. But now here, the kernel tells the program that the action was given to me by IO, and the result I am giving to the result directly. So yeah, I mean IO, I think it will solve a lot of problems from native asynchronous IO. Yeah, that's pretty much it. And I actually did a benchmark on my Linux machine also. I'll just try that.
Even if not reading this as the sole
still there is a considerable improvement when I'm batching all my requests and sending it directly to IOU. So, and also the user space time also increases. But mainly I was focusing on how the system time increased a lot from 170 milliseconds to 70 milliseconds. So yeah, that was pretty much it. I hope this was very informative for all of you. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Yeah, this was 5.18. Let me answer the question.
So I did this on Linux kernel 5.18.6, and because IOU ring is supported from Linux kernel 5.6 onwards, so I have to upgrade my kernel version. And as you can see, you all have Linux have a bypass is not working because of the kernel. So if you want to try IOU ring, you should make sure that you are on Linux kernel version 5.6 onwards.
Compatibility guarantee. is also based upon your OS, right? So my OS is updated. If I run the timestamp currently in my OS, it will basically print the nanosecond. But if I run the same code in, say, Linux machine, it will have nanosecond. So this we found when we were running some tests. Those tests were passing locally, but when we ran it on a Syscalls image which used Linux, it started breaking because the number of digits were not consistent, right? And say Postgres, right? We extensively use Postgres here at Simple. Now in Postgres, what happens is that currently it does not have a support of nanosecond precision. So I created a user object, right? User created that will have nanosecond based on the system that we use. But if I get the object again from database, you can see that the nanosecond is trimmed and it rounds off to the nearest microsecond, right? So the idea is that nanosecond in general has different behavior. It has a lot of intricacies and you should not use it unless you really need it, right? It can be used in IoT applications where you actually need the nanosecond time format. There are different ways to solve it, but in standard like Golang, it is mostly advisable. If you don't store nanosecond, it's still fine, right? So this is what we at Simple use. We have created our own time format, which has 0-0 format. And because we only need time till microsecond, so that it is in sync with what we have stored in database, we have written a custom Marshall JSON. Whenever it is called and whenever we are returning the timestamp, it will basically round to the nearest microsecond and then format it. So this will make sure that we have the microsecond correct. Any questions in this concept? This is a small quiz. Can you predict the outcome?
By
right? Like, why?
Anybody wants to take the answer? Print high is one more answer. Any other thing, guys?
Can you move the mic closer?
Okay, so both the things. Print high is So the output is this, right? It did not go to the panic handler, it did not print it to the hive. Whenever a goroutine panics, it will just crash on your program, right? So there is no such concept as global panic recovery. So suppose you have written a main application, it has a panic recovery, but you have spawned a lot of goroutines. Each goroutine is responsible for handling its own panic, right? This will not be handled, even your main program will crash. So this is what we faced, you know, sometime back here at Super also. We had a lot of goroutines and we were not sure why the main program is exiting, why the main program is crashing, right? And then what we changed is, in each of the goroutines, right, we introduced a panic handler. But now, this also, can you predict the output? Do you think this way of panic handling is correct? So what it does is that I have a main program, right? It calls a function, right? This is not about goroutine, this is about, in general, panic recovery. Now this function, suppose if you're running this in production, right? The idea is a panic handler should capture or should recover the error. It should do some logs, like it should log something, and then it should build the error and return that, so that your main program can take a control of what to do with that error, right? So that with that sense, we wrote a panic handler which sits inside a Unix package, and any function can use it. Can you predict the output whether this will be handled or not? Now questions here, or do you guys have a better implementation on how you handle managing your users? The next topic is zero value. So zero value, as we know, right? So zero value is specific to what data type you're using. Questioning is empty, finding is zero. This is one of the use cases which we stumbled across. So we use UUID heavily for our use cases, right? We have merchants, users, transactions, and the data type we use is UUID. Now this Google UUID package is one of the very famous packages which is used for UUID implementation. So here, this is the IRC standard which is mentioned, right? Now it says that the NIN UUID is a special form of UUID and has to have, you know, all 128 bits set to zero. So say in our case, what happened was that there were few UUIDs which could be NIN, right? So we have a merchant, we have a sub-merchant, sub-merchant can be NIN, it can be empty. Now the dilemma was whether to use a pointer UUID or just use UUID, because UUID by itself provides a nil value, right? Internally it will provide a nil value. If you call dot string on it, it will give you empty string, right? These are some excerpts from, you know, different libraries from JavaScript. They have defined nil as empty value of zeros, and there's also discussion about max UUID, right? Right. So then you know, finally we decided is that we go with pointer UUID. The reason being, nil UUID has a special case. It is represented with, say, some zeros, or it could be an empty string. Now this is an internal implementation of the library which can change also. This is an assumption. Say suppose you want to store nil in your database, but it is possible that, you know, the library converts it into a string of zeros and you are actually storing that in your database, which you won't want, right? So it's always better if the language like Golang, it already provides you with an option to have pointer, then just use it, right? In this case, to avoid ambiguity, it's better, what we felt was that it's better to use the pointer UUID instead of the UUID. And also, like here also, right, this is another example of HTTP transport library.